Welcome to another episode of How It Works with Holger. Today, I want to give an introduction how to bootstrap or not to use bootstrap with TMS Web Core. I found out contracting that a lot of customers that are very, very happy with TMS Web Core are kind of confused how to either start a new project with bootstrap or not to start a new project with bootstrap right from the start. Just as a short introduction, bootstrap in one sentence. Bootstrap is a front-end framework that helps you create responsive and mobile-first websites and web applications efficiently. However, I disagree with this sentence in a way, because honestly, any web application benefits from bootstrap. First of all, you have a common known layout that is used on thousands of web pages and mobile applications. And also, think about it. If you resize your browser window, you still want your application, your web application, to look great. You don't want your user interface to be cut off. You want to be able to use navigation easily, and all these things are included in Bootstrap. You want a common color scheme that is used on other web pages. You want common shapes and accessibility features. All this is guaranteed by Bootstrap. And finally, you want your application to work the same way on any browser. The developers of Bootstrap spend a huge amount of time to make sure that your application works the same way on Microsoft Edge, Chrome, and Safari, for example, to name the three biggest ones. So whenever you start a new project with TMS Web Core, you most likely will go to new, File, New, Other, and then TMS Web, and then you see all the different templates that TMS Web Core offers. And two are the topic of this video. One is the TMS Web Bootstrap application, and the other one is the TMS Web application. And I myself often use the TMS Web application instead of the TMS Web Bootstrap application. The reason is simple. If you pick TMS Web Bootstrap application, which we'll do right now, Bootstrap is actually included in your project right here, these two files. These files become part of your compiled application. So if we compile this application and then look at the application that has been created by right-clicking and going to Open Output Path in Explorer, we see that these two files, which are the Bootstrap source code, so to speak, are part of your compiled application. This is a very big advantage for quite a lot of applications. Because of data privacy laws, you might not want to access external content management servers that host Bootstrap. Instead, you want to host one specific version of Bootstrap, and this is what is guaranteed by using this template. You will use the Bootstrap libraries that are included on your server with your application. Of course, that also means that you need to manage looking at the project HTML file. That means you are responsible to manage the reference to the Bootstrap files when there is supposed to be an update. So this is something to consider. If this is a requirement for you, if this is a preferred solution for you, that is the way to start. Another big advantage is if you look at the form designer and you drop components, they are immediately configured for Bootstrap. For example, this web button here is configured in a way that the element font is set to EFCSS, which means that the font is taken out of the style sheet, Bootstrap in this case, and not from the setting that is set in font. Furthermore, the sizing of the control is handed over to Bootstrap. The height is calculated automatically by Bootstrap. So the height that you define here, I'm going to oversize it, and the width, on the other hand, is absolute. That means the width that we set is being considered. So for example, this button right here, if we run the application and display it in the web browser, this button, the height changes to automatic calculation, but the width stays precisely as we set it. And this can be changed easily. Of course, we can do the width style to auto and start the application again. And we'll see that now both coordinates, x and y, are calculated automatically. And the Bootstrap part is here, the element class names. This is where you can use classes from the Bootstrap library. For example, I want the button in green success color, and I also want my button to be large, so I also use button LG, which makes the button large, and I leave everything on auto, which automatically resizes everything. That also shows you one of the advantages of working with Bootstrap, that size differences are automatically calculated by the browser if you want them to be. Obviously, you might have already created your application, and that is the second part of this video. Go into TMS Web, and let's assume you already have your TMS Web application and you don't have anything added for Bootstrap. So this is the major difference. Your Bootstrap library is not part of your project. Obviously, you can add it just like the template does it. You create a new application using the template, copy the files over, and add the references to your project HTML file. That is option number one, of course, to later on add Bootstrap. However, you might be interested in having Bootstrap hosted somewhere else, or also on a content delivery network that the Bootstrap libraries that is closest to your customer is being used. So this option can be used if you right-click your project and select the JavaScript Library Manager. This manager will come with prepared JavaScript libraries, and Bootstrap is one of them. So here you have the different versions of Bootstrap, and I always pick the most current one, Bootstrap 5.2.3. And I click OK, and now nothing changes on first sight in my project. There are subtle changes, however. If we go to the source code of the HTML file of our project, here we see that Bootstrap has been added just like before with the template. However, the Bootstrap libraries are now hosted on a content delivery network. That automatically picks a server that is close to your customer. For example, if I access this here in the United States, I'm most likely going to get another server than my buddy Bruno over in Belgium. That's just how it works. They want to make it efficient that you get the best speed, the best performance available. The version is here. That is coded. So you don't need to be afraid if you use this approach that you will end up like 5 days later, this server is being updated and you get the new version and your web application no longer is compatible. That will not happen. The version is coded inside of the URL. So this is the main advantage of using this approach. You don't have to care about the libraries. They're hosted externally. That, of course, keeps your application slim and you can focus on your application and not on some external library. The downside, however, is if you have already created forms, like this one, for example, and you drop a button, and we do exactly the same thing, we resize it like this, and we run it, you would expect we added the JavaScript library Bootstrap. This will look like Bootstrap, but it won't. And the reason for that is that Delphi, the form designer, does not know that it is supposed to use Bootstrap. So what you can do is, if you don't have already components on the form, you select the form and go to CSS library and select CSS Bootstrap. And now, as soon as you drop a new button, you will get the behavior again that it will be pre-configured. This works for most standard components, by the way. They're being pre-configured in a way that they look great and work great with Bootstrap. The final topic of this video, of course, is you already have your form. Can you update it to Bootstrap? Well, you have to add the Bootstrap library like we just did. So let's assume we go back, CSS none, and we drop another button. And this button truly is not configured for Bootstrap if we start it. I'll see it right there. And of course, you can add this later on, even though your form is not set to the Bootstrap library. So that is one key fact. The Bootstrap library tag is only something that helps at design time so that the form designer adds these tags when you drop the component on the form. It has nothing to do with your runtime experience per se at first. It does, however, affect runtime. When you, for example, use show message, then the application is going to look in the main form, what kind of framework am I supposed to use for a common appearance. So it is the first step when upgrading an application really should be to flip this to CSS Bootstrap. However, this does not flip any of your existing components. That's the key thing to remember. Then you have to flip this from property to CSS, and the class name you have to add basically button success. And now we still have absolute sizing, meaning if we start the application, the button is sized as it is shown on the form. But it is now a Bootstrap styled button. And if I add, for example, width style to auto and the height style to auto, this will automatically resize according to the font and everything that is set by Bootstrap. You see that the font also changes to the standard Bootstrap font. If you want a large button for better accessibility, button large, and for example like this, then you get a large representation, or we can do button outline. Success is another button class. And you just get the outline, the button won't be filled. There we go. And if you want to know, how does Holger know all these things? Holger doesn't know anything. He's old. He can't remember these things either. So we need to go to get Bootstrap, docs, and then let me do this in full screen. We go, for example, to buttons. It's somewhere here. All the different button files, buttons, base class. And there you see the different colors that are available with the button primary. Remember, this is required, and then this, it doesn't suffice if you just say button primary. I fell into the same trap because this adds some styles, and then this adds even more. It is an additive process. Also, the order might be important. So you always start with button and then button secondary or whatever you want to use. And if you keep going down, you see the outline variations, the different sizes that are available. There's even the small, or you can, with custom variables in your CSS, you can even affect the size as you want. There's also the ability for button groups. I'm diverting. Bootstrap is an amazing framework, which I've just shown you can very, very easily integrate into your existing application and should always be a consideration when you create new applications. Thank you for joining us for another episode of How It Works with Holger. Please give us a thumbs up if you like this. Comment on this video if you have ideas for further topics. Stay safe. Take care.